Susy, A Story of the Plains. By Bret Harte. Podcast 5 of 6. Chapter 9. Without disclosing the full extent of Jim's defection and desertion, Clarence was able to truthfully assure the Hopkins family of his personal safety, and to promise that he would continue his quest, and send them further news of the absentee. He believed it would be found that Jim had been called away on some important business, but that not daring to leave his new shanty exposed and temptingly unprotected, he had made a virtue of necessity by selling it to his neighbors, intending to build a better house on its site after his return. Having comforted Phoebe, and impulsively conceived further plans for restoring Jim to her happily without any recurrence of his previous doubts as to his own efficacy as a special providence, he returned to the rancho. If he thought again of Jim's defection and Gilroy's warning, it was only to strengthen himself to a clearer perception of his unselfish duty and singleness of purpose. He would give up brooding, apply himself more practically to the management of the property, carry out his plans for the foundation of a landlord's protective league for the southern counties, become a candidate for the legislature, and, in brief, try to fill Peyton's place in the county as he had at the rancho. He would endeavor to become better acquainted with the half-breed laborers on the estate and avoid the friction between them and the Americans. He was conscious that he had not made that use of his early familiarity with their ways and language which he might have done. If, occasionally, the figure of the young Spaniard whom he had met on the lonely road obtruded itself on him, it was always with the instinctive premonition that he would meet him again, and the mystery of the sudden repulsion be in some way explained. Thus Clarence. But the momentary impulse that had driven him to Fair Plains, the eagerness to set his mind at rest regarding Susy and her relatives, he had utterly forgotten. Howbeit, some of the energy and enthusiasm that he breathed into these various essays made their impression. He succeeded in forming the Landlords' League, under a commission suggested by him. The straggling boundaries of Robles and the adjacent claims were resurveyed, defined, and mutually protected, even the lawless Gilroy, from extending an amused toleration to the young administrator, grew to recognize and accept him. The peons and vaqueros began to have faith in a man who acknowledged them sufficiently to rebuild the ruined mission chapel on the estate, and save them the long pilgrimage to Santa Inez on Sundays and Saints' Days. The San Francisco priest imported from Clarence's old college at San Jose, and an habitual guest at Clarence's hospitable board, was grateful enough to fill his flock with loyalty to the young padrone. He had returned from a long drive one afternoon, and had just thrown himself into an easy chair with the comfortable consciousness of a rest fairly earned. The dull embers of a fire occasionally glowed in the oven-like hearth, although the open casement of a window let in the soft breath of the southwest trades. The Angelus had just rung from the restored chapel, and, mellowed by distance, seemed to Clarence to lend that repose to the windswept landscape that it had always lacked. Suddenly his quick ear detected the sound of wheels in the ruts of the carriageway. Usually his visitors to the casa came on horseback, and carts and wagons used only the lower road. As the sound approached nearer, an odd fancy filled his heart with unaccountable pleasure. Could it be Mrs. Peyton making an unexpected visit to the rancho? He held his breath. The vehicle was now rolling on into the patio. The clatter of hoofs and a halt were followed by the accents of women's voices. One seemed familiar. He rose quickly, as light footsteps ran along the corridor, and then the door opened impetuously to the laughing face of Susy. He came towards her hastily, yet with only the simple impulse of astonishment. He had no thought of kissing her, but as he approached, she threw her charming head archly to one side, with a mischievous knitting of her brows and a significant gesture towards the passage, that indicated the proximity of a stranger and the possibility of interruption. "Hush! Mrs. McCloskey's here," she whispered. "Mrs. McCloskey," repeated Clarence vaguely. "Yes, of course," impatiently. "My Aunt Jane." "Silly! We just cut away down here to surprise you. Auntie's never seen the place, and here was a good chance. And your mother, Mrs. Peyton? Does she? Stammered Clarence. "Does she, mimicked Susy, with increasing impatience. "Why, Of course she doesn't know anything about it. She thinks I'm visiting Mary Rogers at Oakland. And I am afterwards, she laughed. I just wrote to Aunt Jane to meet me at Alameda, and we took the stage to Santa Ynez and drove on here in a buggy. Wasn't it real fun? Tell me, Clarence. You don't say anything. Tell me, wasn't it real fun? This was all so like her old, childlike, charming, irresponsible self, that Clarence, troubled and bewildered as he was, took her hands and drew her like a child towards him. Of course, she went on, yet stopping to smell a rosebud in his buttonhole, I have a perfect right to come to my own home, goodness knows, and if I bring my own aunt, a married woman, with me, although, loftily, there may be a young unmarried gentleman alone there, still I fail to see any impropriety in it. He was still holding her, but in that instant her manner had completely changed again. The old Susy seemed to have slipped away and evaded him, and he was retaining only a conscious actress in his arms. Release me, Mr. Brandt, please, she said, with a languid affected glance behind her, we are not alone. Then, as the rustling of a skirt sounded nearer in the passage, she seemed to change back to her old self once more, and with a lightning flash of significance whispered. She knows everything. To add to Clarence's confusion, the woman who entered cast a quick glance of playful meaning on the separating youthful pair. She was an ineffective blonde with a certain beauty that seemed to be gradually succumbing to the ravages of paint and powder rather than years. Her dress appeared to have suffered from an equally unwise excess of ornamentation and trimming, and she gave the general impression of having been intended for exhibition in almost any other light than the one in which she happened to be. There were two or three mud stains on the laces of her sleeve and underskirt that were obtrusively incongruous. Her voice, which had, however, a ring of honest intention in it, was somewhat overstrained, and evidently had not yet adjusted itself to the low-ceilinged, conventual-like building. There, children, don't mind me. I know I'm not on in this scene, but I got nervous waiting there, in what you call the salon, with only those greaser servants staring round me in a circle, like a regular chorus. My! But it's antique here, regular antique Spanish. Then, with a glance at Clarence, so this is Clarence Brandt, your Clarence. Introduce me, Susy. In his confusion of indignation, pain, and even a certain conception of the grim ludicrousness of the situation, Clarence grasped despairingly at the single sentence of Susie's. In my own home. Surely, at least, it was her own home, and as he was only the business agent of her adopted mother, he had no right to dictate to her under what circumstances she should return to it, or whom she should introduce there. In her independence and caprice, Susy might easily have gone elsewhere with this astounding relative, and would Mrs. Peyton like it better? Clinging to this idea, his instinct of hospitality asserted itself. He welcomed Mrs. McCloskey with nervous effusion. I am only Mrs. Peyton's major domo here, but any guest of her daughter's is welcome. Yes, said Mrs. McCloskey, with ostentatious archness, I reckon Susy and I understand your position here, and you've got a good berth of it. But we won't trouble you much on Mrs. Peyton's account, will we, Susy? And now she and me will just take a look around the shanty. It is real old Spanish antique, ain't it, and sorter take stock of it, and you young folks will have to tear yourselves apart for a while, and play propriety before me. You've got to be on your good behavior while I'm here, I can tell you. I'm a heavy old duenna. Ain't I, Susy? School ma MS and mother superiors ain't in the game with me for discipline. She threw her arms around the young girl's waist and drew her towards her affectionately, an action that slightly precipitated some powder upon the black dress of her niece. Susy glanced mischievously at Clarence, but withdrew her eyes presently to let them rest with unmistakable appreciation and admiration on her relative. A pang shot through Clarence's breast. He had never seen her look in that way at Mrs. Peyton. Yet here was this stranger, provincial, overdressed, and extravagant, whose vulgarity was only made tolerable through her good humor, who had awakened that interest which the refined Mrs. Peyton had never yet been able to touch. As Mrs. McCloskey swept out of the room with Susy, he turned away with a sinking heart. Yet it was necessary that the Spanish house servants should not suspect this treason to their mistress, and Clarence stopped their childish curiosity about the stranger with a careless and easy acceptance of Susie's sudden visit in the light of an ordinary occurrence, and with a familiarity towards Mrs. McCloskey which became the more distasteful to him in proportion as he saw that it was evidently agreeable to her. But, easily responsive, she became speedily confidential. Without a single question from himself, or a contributing remark from Susie, in half an hour she had told him her whole history. How, as Jane Silsby, an elder sister of Susie's mother, she had early eloped from the paternal home in Kansas with McCloskey, a strolling actor. How she had married him and gone on the stage under his stage name, effectively preventing any recognition by her family. How, coming to California, where her husband had become manager of the theater at Sacramento, she was indignant to find that her only surviving relation, a sister-in-law, living in the same place, had for a money consideration given up all claim to the orphan Susie, and how she had resolved to find out if the poor child was happy. How she succeeded in finding out that she was not happy. How she wrote to her, and even met her secretly at San Francisco and Oakland, and how she had undertaken this journey partly for a lark, and partly to see Clarence and the property. There was no doubt of the speaker's sincerity. With this outrageous candor there was an equal obliviousness of any indelicacy in her conduct towards Mrs. Peyton that seemed hopeless. Yet he must talk plainly to her, he must say to her what he could not say to Susie. Upon her Mrs. Peyton's happiness he believed he was thinking of Susie's also depended. He must take the first opportunity of speaking to her alone. That opportunity came sooner than he had expected. After dinner, Mrs. McCloskey turned to Susie, and playfully telling her that she had to talk business with Mr. Brandt, bade her go to the salon and await her. When the young girl left the room, she looked at Clarence, and, with that assumption of curtness with which coarse but kindly natures believe they overcome the difficulty of delicate subjects, said abruptly, "Well, young man, now what's all this between you and Susie? I'm looking after her interests same as if she was my own girl. If you've got anything to say, now's your time. And don't you shilly-shally too long over it, either, for you might as well know that a girl like that can have her pick and choice, and be beholden to no one, and when she don't care to choose, there's me and my husband ready to do for her all the same. We mightn't be able to do the antique Spanish squire, but we've got our own line of business, and it's a comfortable one." To have this said to him under the roof of Mrs. Peyton, from whom, in his sensitiveness, he had thus far jealously guarded his own secret, was even more than Clarence's gentleness could stand, and fixed his wavering resolution. "I don't think we quite understand each other, Mrs. McCloskey," he said coldly, but with glittering eyes. "I have certainly something to say to you, if it is not on a subject as pleasant as the one you propose, it is, nevertheless, one that I think you and I are more competent to discuss together." Then, with quiet but unrelenting directness, he pointed out to her that Susie was a legally adopted daughter of Mrs. Peyton, and, as a minor, utterly under her control, that Mrs. Peyton had no knowledge of any opposing relatives, and that Susie had not only concealed the fact from her, but that he was satisfied that Mrs. Peyton did not even know of Susie's discontent and alienation, that she had tenderly and carefully brought up the helpless orphan as her own child, and even if she had not gained her affection was at least entitled to her obedience and respect, that while Susie's girlish caprice and inexperience excused her conduct, Mrs. Peyton and her friends would have a right to expect more consideration from a person of Mrs. McCloskey's maturer judgment. That for these reasons, and as the friend of Mrs. Peyton, whom he could alone recognize as Susie's guardian and the arbiter of her affections, he must decline to discuss the young girl with any reference to himself or his own intentions. An unmistakable flush asserted itself under the lady's powder. "Suit yourself, young man, suit yourself," she said, with equally direct resentment and antagonism, only mebbe you'll let me tell you that Jim McCloskey ain't no fool, and mebbe knows what lawyers think of an arrangement with a sister-in-law that leaves a real sister out? Mebbe that's a sister's title you ain't thought of, Mr. Brandt. And mebbe you'll find out that your chance o' getting Mrs. Peyton's consent ain't as safe to gamble on as you reckon it is. And mebbe, what's more to the purpose, if you did get it, it might not be just the trump card to fetch Susy with. And to wind up, Mr. Brandt, when you do have to come down to the bedrock and me and Jim McCloskey, you may find out that him and me have discovered a better match for Susy than the son of old Ham Brandt, who is trying to play the Spanish grandee off his father's money on a couple of women. And we mayn't have to go far to do it or to get the real thing, Mr. Brandt. Too heartsick and disgusted to even notice the slur upon himself or the import of her last words, Clarence only rose and bowed as she jumped up from the table. But as she reached the door he said, half appealingly, "Whatever are your other intentions, Mrs. McCloskey, as we are both Susie's guests, I beg you will say nothing of this to her while we are here, and particularly that you will not allow her to think for a moment that I have discussed my relations to her with anybody." She flung herself out of the door without a reply, but on entering the dark low-ceilinged drawing room she was surprised to find that Susy was not there. She was consequently obliged to return to the veranda, where Clarence had withdrawn, and to somewhat ostentatiously demand of the servants that Susy should be sent to her room at once. But the young girl was not in her own room, and was apparently nowhere to be found. Clarence, who had now fully determined as a last resource to make a direct appeal to Susy herself, listened to this fruitless search with some concern. She could not have gone out in the rain, which was again falling. She might be hiding somewhere to avoid a recurrence of the scene she had perhaps partly overheard. He turned into the corridor that led to Mrs. Peyton's boudoir. As he knew that it was locked, he was surprised to see by the dim light of the hanging lamp that a duplicate key to the one in his desk was in the lock. It must be Susie's, and the young girl had probably taken refuge there. He knocked gently. There was a rustle in the room and the sound of a chair being moved, but no reply. Impelled by a sudden instinct, he opened the door, and was met by a cool current of air from some open window. At the same moment the figure of Susy approached him from the semi-darkness of the interior. "I did not know you were here," said Clarence, much relieved, he knew not why, "but I am glad, for I wanted to speak with you alone for a few moments." She did not reply, but he drew a match from his pocket and lit the two candles which he knew stood on the table. The wick of one was still warm, as if it had been recently extinguished. As the light slowly radiated, he could see that she was regarding him with an air of affected unconcern, but a somewhat heightened color. It was like her, and not inconsistent with his idea that she had come there to avoid an after scene with Mrs. McCloskey or himself, or perhaps both. The room was not disarranged in any way. The window that was opened was the casement of the deep embrasured one in the rear wall, and the light curtain before it still swayed occasionally in the night wind. "I'm afraid I had a row with your aunt, Susy," he began lightly, in his old familiar way, "but I had to tell her I didn't think her conduct to Mrs. Peyton was exactly the square thing towards one who had been as devoted to you as she has been." "Oh, for goodness sake, don't go over all that again," said Susy impatiently. "I've had enough of it." Clarence flashed, but recovered himself. "Then you overheard what I said, and know what I think," he said calmly. "I knew it before," said the young girl, with a slight supercilious toss of the head, and yet a certain abstraction of manner as she went to the window and closed it. "Anybody could see it. I know you always wanted me to stay here with Mrs. Peyton, and be coddled and monitored and catechized and shut up away from anyone, until you had been coddled and monitored and catechized by somebody else sufficiently to suit her ideas of your being a fit husband for me. I told Auntie it was no use our coming here to do." "To do what?" asked Clarence. "To put some spirit into you," said the young girl, turning upon him sharply, "to keep you from being tied to that woman's apron strings. To keep her from making a slave of you as she would of me. But it is of no use. Mary Rogers was right when she said you had no wish to please anybody but Mrs. Peyton, and no eyes for anybody but her. And if it hadn't been too ridiculous, considering her age and yours, she'd say you were dead in love with her. For an instant Clarence felt the blood rush to his face and then sink away, leaving him pale and cold. The room, which had seemed to whirl around him, and then fade away, returned with appalling distinctness the distinctness of memory and a vision of the first day that he had seen Mrs. Peyton sitting there, as he seemed to see her now. For the first time there flashed upon him the conviction that the young girl had spoken the truth, and had brusquely brushed the veil from his foolish eyes. He was in love with Mrs. Peyton. That was what his doubts and hesitation regarding Susy meant. That alone was the source, secret, and limit of his vague ambition. But with the conviction came a singular calm. In the last few moments he seemed to have grown older, to have loosed the bonds of old companionship with Susy, and the later impression she had given him of her mature knowledge, and moved on far beyond her years and experience. And it was with an authority that was half paternal, and in a voice he himself scarcely recognized, that he said, "If I did not know you were prejudiced by a foolish and indiscreet woman, I should believe that you were trying to insult me as you have your adopted mother, and would save you the pain of doing both in her house by leaving it now and forever. But because I believe you are controlled against your best instinct by that woman, I shall remain here with you to frustrate her as best I can, or until I am able to lay everything before Mrs. Peyton except the foolish speech you have just made." The young girl laughed. "Why not that one too, while you're about it? See what she'll say." "I shall tell her," continued Clarence calmly, "only what you yourself have made it necessary for me to tell her to save you from folly and disgrace, and only enough to spare her the mortification of hearing it first from her own servants." "Hearing what from her own servants? What do you mean? How dare you?" demanded the young girl sharply. She was quite real in her anxiety now, although her attitude of virtuous indignation struck him as being like all her emotional expression, namely, acting. "I mean that the servants know of your correspondence with Mrs. McCloskey, and that she claims to be your aunt," returned Clarence. "They know that you confided to Pepita. They believe that either Mrs. McCloskey or you have seen." He had stopped suddenly. He was about to say that the servants, particularly Incarnation, knew that Pedro had boasted of having met Susy, when, for the first time, the tremendous significance of what he had hitherto considered as merely an idle falsehood flashed upon him. "Seen whom?" repeated Susy in a higher voice, impatiently stamping her foot. Clarence looked at her, and in her excited, questioning face saw a confirmation of his still half-formed suspicions. In his own abrupt pause and knitted eyebrows she must have read his thoughts also. Their eyes met. Her violet pupils dilated, trembled, and then quickly shifted as she suddenly stiffened into an attitude of scornful indifference, almost grotesque in its unreality. His eyes slowly turned to the window, the door, the candles on the table and the chair before it, and then came back to her face again. Then he drew a deep breath. "I give no heed to the idle gossip of servants, Susy," he said slowly. "I have no belief that you have ever contemplated anything worse than an act of girlish folly, or the gratification of a passing caprice. Neither do I want to appeal to you or frighten you, but I must tell you now, that I know certain facts that might make such a simple act of folly monstrous, inconceivable in you, and almost accessory to a crime. I can tell you no more. But so satisfied am I of such a possibility, that I shall not scruple to take any means the strongest to prevent even the remotest chance of it. Your aunt has been looking for you, you had better go to her now. I will close the room and lock the door. Meantime, I should advise you not to sit so near an open window with a candle at night in this locality. Even if it might not be dangerous for you, it might be fatal to the foolish creatures it might attract." He took the key from the door as he held it open for her to pass out. She uttered a shrill little laugh, like a nervous, mischievous child, and, slipping out of her previous artificial attitude as if it had been a mantle, ran out of the room. Chapter 10. As Susie's footsteps died away, Clarence closed the door, walked to the window, and examined it closely. The bars had been restored since he had wrenched them off to give ingress to the family on the day of recapture. He glanced around the room, nothing seemed to have been disturbed. Nevertheless, he was uneasy. The suspicions of a frank, trustful nature when once aroused are apt to be more general and far-reaching than the specific distrusts of the disingenuous, for they imply the overthrow of a whole principle and not a mere detail. Clarence's conviction that Susy had seen Pedro recently since his dismissal led him into the wildest surmises of her motives. It was possible that without her having reason to suspect Pedro's greater crime, he might have confided to her his intention of reclaiming the property and installing her as the mistress and chatelaine of the rancho. The idea was one that might have appealed to Susie's theatrical imagination. He recalled Mrs. McCloskey's sneer at his own pretensions and her vague threats of a rival of more lineal descent. The possible infidelity of Susie to himself touched him lightly when the first surprise was over. Indeed, it scarcely could be called infidelity, if she knew and believed Mary Rogers' discovery, and the conviction that he and she had really never loved each other now enabled him, as he believed, to look at her conduct dispassionately. Yet it was her treachery to Mrs. Peyton and not to himself that impressed him most, and perhaps made him equally unjust, through his affections. He extinguished the candles, partly from some vague precautions he could not explain, and partly to think over his fears in the abstraction and obscurity of the semi-darkness. The higher windows suffused a faint light on the ceiling, and, assisted by the dark lantern-like glow cast on the opposite wall by the tunnel of the embrasured window, the familiar outlines of the room and its furniture came back to him. Somewhat in this fashion also, in the obscurity and quiet, came back to him the events he had overlooked and forgotten. He recalled now some gossip of the servants, and hints dropped by Susie of a violent quarrel between Peyton and Pedro, which resulted in Pedro's dismissal, but which now seemed clearly attributable to some graver cause than inattention and insolence. He recalled Mary Rogers' playful pleasantries with Susie about Pedro, and Susie's mysterious air, which he had hitherto regarded only as part of her exaggeration. He remembered Mrs. Peyton's unwarrantable uneasiness about Susie, which he had either overlooked or referred entirely to himself. She must have suspected something. To his quickened imagination, in this ruin of his faith and trust, he believed that Hooker's defection was either part of the conspiracy, or that he had run away to avoid being implicated with Susie in its discovery. This, too, was the significance of Gilroy's parting warning. He and Mrs. Peyton alone had been blind and confiding in the midst of this treachery, and even he had been blind to his own real affections. The wind had risen again, and the faint light on the opposite wall grew tremulous and shifting with the movement of the foliage without. But presently the glow became quite obliterated, as if by the intervention of some opaque body outside the window. He rose hurriedly and went to the casement. But at the same moment he fancied he heard the jamming of a door or window in quite another direction, and his examination of the casement before him showed him only the silver light of the thinly clouded sky falling uninterruptedly through the bars and foliage on the interior of the whitewashed embrasure. Then a conception of his mistake flashed across him. The line of the casa was long, straggling, and exposed elsewhere. Why should the attempt to enter or communicate with anyone within be confined only to this single point? And why not satisfy himself at once if any trespassers were lounging around the walls, and then confront them boldly in the open? Their discovery and identification was as important as the defeat of their intentions. He relit the candle, and, placing it on a small table by the wall beyond the visual range of the window, rearranged the curtain so that, while it permitted the light to pass out, it left the room in shadow. He then opened the door softly, locked it behind him, and passed noiselessly into the hall. Susie's and Mrs. McCloskey's rooms were at the further end of the passage, but between them and the boudoir was the open patio, and the low murmur of the voices of servants, who still lingered until he should dismiss them for the night. Turning back, he moved silently down the passage, until he reached the narrow arched door to the garden. This he unlocked and opened with the same stealthy caution. The rain had recommenced. Not daring to risk a return to his room, he took from a peg in the recess an old waterproof cloak and sou'wester of Peyton's, which still hung there, and passed out into the night, locking the door behind him. To keep the knowledge of his secret patrol from the stableman, he did not attempt to take out his own horse, but trusted to find some vaquero's mustang in the corral. By good luck an old bluegrass hack of Peyton's, nearest the stockade as he entered, allowed itself to be quickly caught. Using its rope head stall for a bridle, Clarence vaulted on its bare back, and paced cautiously out into the road. Here he kept the curve of the long line of stockade until he reached the outlying field where, half hidden in the withered, sapless, but still standing stalks of grain, he slowly began a circuit of the casa. The misty gray dome above him, which an invisible moon seemed to have quicksilvered over, alternately lightened and darkened with passing gusts of fine rain. Nevertheless, he could see the outline of the broad quadrangle of the house quite distinctly, except on the west side, where a fringe of writhing willows beat the brown adobe walls with their imploring arms at every gust. Elsewhere nothing moved, the view was uninterrupted to where the shining, watery sky met the equally shining, watery plain. He had already made a half circuit of the house, and was still noiselessly picking his way along the furrows, muffled with soaked and broken down blades, and the velvety upspringing of the volunteer growth, when suddenly, not 50 yards before him, without sound or warning, a figure rode out of the grain upon the open crossroad, and deliberately halted with a listless, abstracted, waiting air. Clarence instantly recognized one of his own vaqueros, an undersized half-breed, but he as instantly divined that he was only an outpost or confederate, stationed to give the alarm. The same precaution had prevented each hearing the other, and the lesser height of the vaquero had rendered him indistinguishable as he preceded Clarence among the grain. As the young man made no doubt that the real trespasser was nearer the casa, along the line of willows, he wheeled to intercept him without alarming his sentry. Unfortunately, his horse answered the rope bridle clumsily, and splashed in striking out. The watcher quickly raised his head, and Clarence knew that his only chance was now to suppress him. Determined to do this at any hazard, with a threatening gesture he charged boldly down upon him. But he had not crossed half the distance between them when the man uttered an appalling cry, so wild and despairing that it seemed to chill even the hot blood in Clarence's veins, and dashed frenziedly down the crossroad into the interminable plain. Before Clarence could determine if that cry was a signal or an involuntary outburst, it was followed instantly by the sound of frightened and struggling hoofs clattering against the wall of the casa, and a swaying of the shrubbery near the back gate of the patio. Here was his real quarry. Without hesitation he dug his heels into the flanks of his horse and rode furiously towards it. As he approached, a long tremor seemed to pass through the shrubbery, with the retreating sound of horse hoofs. The unseen trespasser had evidently taken the alarm and was fleeing, and Clarence dashed in pursuit. Following the sound, for the shrubbery hid the fugitive from view, he passed the last wall of the casa, but it soon became evident that the unknown had the better horse. The hoofbeats grew fainter and fainter, and at times appeared even to cease, until his own approach started them again, eventually to fade away in the distance. In vain Clarence dug his heels into the flanks of his heavier steed, and regretted his own mustang, and when at last he reached the edge of the thicket he had lost both sight and sound of the fugitive. The descent to the lower terrace lay before him empty and desolate. The man had escaped. He turned slowly back with baffled anger and vindictiveness. However, he had prevented something, although he knew not what. The principal had got away, but he had identified his confederate, and for the first time held a clue to his mysterious visitant. There was no use to alarm the household, which did not seem to have been disturbed. The trespassers were far away by this time, and the attempt would hardly be repeated that night. He made his way quietly back to the corral, let loose his horse, and regained the casa unobserved. He unlocked the arched door in the wall, re-entered the darkened passage, stopped a moment to open the door of the boudoir, glance at the closely fastened casement, and extinguish the still-burning candle, and, relocking the door securely, made his way to his own room. but he could not sleep. The whole incident, over so quickly, had nevertheless impressed him deeply, and yet like a dream. The strange yell of the vaquero still rang in his ears, but with an unearthly and superstitious significance that was even more dreamlike in its meaning. He awakened from a fitful slumber to find the light of morning in the room, and Incarnation standing by his bedside. The yellow face of the steward was greenish with terror, and his lips were dry. "Get up, Señor Clarencio, get up at once, my master. Strange things have happened. Mother of God, protect us." Clarence rolled to his feet, with the events of the past night struggling back upon his consciousness. "What mean you, Nacio?" he said, grasping the man's arm, which was still mechanically making the sign of the cross, as he muttered incoherently. "Speak, I command you. It is Jose, the little vaquero, who is even now at the padre's house, raving as a lunatic, stricken as a madman with terror. He has seen him the dead alive. Save us."
"Are you mad yourself, Nacio?" said Clarence.
"Whom has he seen?"
"Whom?
God help us. The old padrone, Señor Peyton himself. He rushed towards him here, in the patio, last night out of the air, the sky, the ground, he knew not his own self, wrapped in his old storm cloak and hat, and riding his own horse erect, terrible, and menacing, with an awful hand upholding a rope so. He saw him with these eyes, as I see you. What he said to him, God knows. The priest, perhaps, for he has made confession." In a flash of intelligence Clarence comprehended all. He rose grimly and began to dress himself. "Not a word of this to the women, to anyone, Nacio, dost thou understand?" he said curtly. "It may be that Jose has been partaking too freely of aguardiente, it is possible. I will see the priest myself. But what possesses thee? Collect thyself, good Nacio." But the man was still trembling. "It is not all, Mother of God, it is not all, Master," he stammered, dropping to his knees and still crossing himself. "This morning, beside the corral, they find the horse of Pedro Valdez splashed and spattered on saddle and bridle, and in the stirrup dost thou hear, the stirrup hanging, the torn off boot of Valdez. Ah, God! The same as his. Now do you understand? It is his vengeance. No. Jesu forgive me. It is the vengeance of God." Clarence was staggered. "And you have not found Valdez? You have looked for him," he said, hurriedly throwing on his clothes. "Everywhere, all over the plain. The whole rancho has been out since sunrise, here and there and everywhere. And there is nothing." "Of course not. What would you?" He pointed solemnly to the ground. "Nonsense," said Clarence, buttoning his coat and seizing his hat. "Follow me." He ran down the passage, followed by Incarnation, through the excited, gesticulating crowd of servants in the patio, and out of the back gate. He turned first along the wall of the casa towards the barred window of the boudoir. Then a cry came from Incarnation. They ran quickly forward. Hanging from the grating of the window, like a mass of limp and saturated clothes, was the body of Pedro Valdez, with one unbooted foot dangling within an inch of the ground. His head was passed inside the grating and fixed as at that moment when the first spring of the frightened horse had broken his neck between the bars as in a garrote, and the second plunge of the terrified animal had carried off his boot in the caught stirrup when it escaped. Chapter 11. The winter rains were over and gone, and the whole long line of Californian coast was dashed with color. There were miles of yellow and red poppies, leagues of lupins that painted the gently rounded hills with soft primary hues, and long continuous slopes, like low mountain systems, of daisies and dandelions. At Sacramento it was already summer, the Yellow River was flashing and intolerable, the tule and marsh grasses were lush and long, the bloom of cottonwood and sycamore whitened the outskirts of the city, and as Cyrus Hopkins and his daughter Phoebe looked from the veranda of the Placer Hotel, accustomed as they were to the cool trade winds of the coast valleys, they felt homesick from the memory of eastern heats.
Later, when they were surveying the long dinner tables at the table d'hôte with something of the uncomfortable and shamefaced loneliness of the provincial, Phoebe uttered a slight cry and clutched her father's arm. Mr. Hopkins stayed the play of his squared elbows and glanced inquiringly at his daughter's face. There was a pretty animation in it, as she pointed to a figure that had just entered. It was that of a young man attired in the extravagance rather than the taste of the prevailing fashion, which did not, however, in the least conceal a decided rusticity of limb and movement. A long mustache, which looked unkempt, even in its pomatumed stiffness, and lank, dark hair that had bent but never curled under the barber's iron, made him notable even in that heterogeneous assembly. "That's he," whispered Phoebe. "Who?" said her father. Alas for the inconsistencies of love. The blush came with the name and not the vision. "Mr. Hooker," she stammered. It was, indeed, Jim Hooker. But the role of his exaggeration was no longer the same, the remorseful gloom in which he had been habitually steeped had changed into a fatigued, yet haughty, fastidiousness more in keeping with his fashionable garments. He was more peaceful, yet not entirely placable, and, as he sat down at a side table and pulled down his striped cuffs with his clasped fingers, he cast a glance of critical disapproval on the general company. Nevertheless, he seemed to be furtively watchful of his effect upon them, and as one or two whispered and looked towards him, his consciousness became darkly manifest. All of which might have intimidated the gentle Phoebe, but did not discompose her father. He rose, and crossing over to Hooker's table, clapped him heartily on the back. "How do, Hooker? I didn't recognize you in them fine clothes, but Phoebe guessed as how it was you." Flushed, disconcerted, irritated, but always in wholesome awe of Mr. Hopkins, Jim returned his greeting awkwardly and half hysterically. How he would have received the more timid Phoebe is another question. But Mr. Hopkins, without apparently noticing these symptoms, went on. "We're only just down, Phoebe and me, and as I guess we'll want to talk over old times, we'll come alongside you. Hold on, and I'll fetch her." The interval gave the unhappy Jim a chance to recover himself, to regain his vanished cuffs, display his heavy watch chain, curl his mustache, and otherwise reassume his air of blasé fastidiousness. But the transfer made, Phoebe, after shaking hands, became speechless under these perfections. Not so her father. "If there's anything in looks, you seem to be prospering," he said grimly, "unless you're in the tail or in line, and you're only showin' off stock. What mout ye be doing?" "Ye ain't been long in Sacramento, I reckon," suggested Jim, with patronizing pity. "No, we only came this morning," returned Hopkins. "And you ain't been to the theater," continued Jim. "No. Nor moved much in general fashionable society." "Not yet," interposed Phoebe, with an air of faint apology. "Nor seen any of them large posters on the fences, of The Prairie Flower, or Red-Handed Dick, three-act play with five tableaus just the biggest sensation outrunnin' for 40 nights money turned away every night stand in room only," continued Jim, with prolonged toleration. "No. Well, I play Red-Handed Dick. I thought you might have seen it and recognized me. All those people over there," darkly indicating the long table, "know me. A fellow can't stand it, you know, being stared at by such a vulgar, low-bred lot. It's getting too fresh here. I'll have to give the landlord notice and cut the whole hotel. They don't seem to have ever seen a gentleman and a professional before." "Then you're a play actor now," said the farmer, in a tone which did not, however, exhibit the exact degree of admiration which shone in Phoebe's eyes. "For the present," said Jim, with lofty indifference. "You see, I was in partnership with McCloskey, the manager, and I didn't like the style of the chump that was doing Red-Handed Dick, so I offered to take his place one night to show him how. And by jinks, the audience, after that night, wouldn't let anybody else play it, wouldn't stand even the biggest, highest-priced stars in it. I reckon," he added gloomily, I'll have to run the darn thing in all the big towns in California if I don't have to go east with it after all, just for the business. But it's an awful grind on a man, leaves him no time, along of the invitations he gets, and what with being run after in the streets and stared at in the hotels, he don't get no privacy. There's men, and women, too, over at that table, that just lie in wait for me here till I come, and don't lift their eyes off me. I wonder they don't bring their opery glasses with them. Concerned, sympathizing, and indignant, poor Phoebe turned her brown head and honest eyes in that direction. But because they were honest, they could not help observing that the other table did not seem to be paying the slightest attention to the distinguished impersonator of Red-Handed Dick. Perhaps he had been overheard. Then that was the reason ye didn't come back to your location. I always guessed it was because you'd got wind of the smash up down there, afore we did, said Hopkins grimly. What smash up? Asked Jim, with slightly resentful quickness. Why, the smash up of the sister's title, didn't you hear that? There was a slight movement of relief and a return of gloomy hauteur in Jim's manner. No, we don't know much of what goes on in the cow counties, up here. Yem out, considerin' it concerns some o' your friends, returned Hopkins dryly. For the sister's title went smash as soon as it was known that Pedro Valdez, the man as started it, had his neck broken outside the walls o' Robles Rancho, and they do say as this year Brandt, your friend, had suthin' to do with the breaking of it, though it was laid to the ghost of old Peyton. Anyhow, there was such a big skeer that one of the greaser gang, who thought he'd seen the ghost, being a papist, to save his everlasting soul, went to the priest and confessed. But the priest wouldn't give him absolution until he'd blown the whole thing, and made it public. And then it turned out that all the documents for the title, and even the custom house paper, were forged by Pedro Valdez, and put on the market by his confederates. And that's just where your friend, Clarence Brandt, comes in, for he had bought up the whole title from them fellers. Now, either, as some say, he was in the fraud from the beginning, and never paid anything, or else he was an all-fired fool, and had parted with his money like one. Some allow that the reason was that he was awfully sweet on Mrs. Peyton's adopted daughter, and ez the parents didn't approve of him, he did this so as to get a hold over them by the property. But he's a ruined man, anyway, now, for they say he's such a darn fool that he's going to pay for all the improvements that the folks who bought under him put into the land, and that'll take his last cent. I thought I'd tell you that, for I suppose you've lost a heap in your improvements, and will put in your claim. I reckon I put nearly as much into it as Clar Brandt did, said Jim gloomily, but I ain't going to take a cent from him, or go back on him now. The rascal could not resist this last mendacious opportunity, although he was perfectly sincere in his renunciation, touched in his sympathy, and there was even a film of moisture in his shifting eyes. Phoebe was thrilled with the generosity of this noble being, who could be unselfish even in his superior condition. She added softly, "And they say that the girl did not care for him at all, but was actually going to run off with Pedro, when he stopped her and sent for Mrs. Peyton." To her surprise, Jim's face flushed violently. "It's all a dod blasted lie," he said, in a thick stage whisper. "It's only the hogwash them greasers and Pike County galoots ladle out to each other around the stove in a county grocery." But, recalling himself loftily, and with a tolerant wave of his bediamonded hand, "what can you expect from one of them cow counties? They ain't satisfied till they drive every gentleman out of the darned gopher holes they call their country." In her admiration of what she believed to be a loyal outburst for his friend, Phoebe overlooked the implied sneer at her provincial home. But her father went on with a perfunctory, exasperating, dusty aridity. "That mebbe easy mebbe, Mr. Hooker, but the story down in our precinct goes that she gave Mrs. Peyton the slip, chucked up her situation as adopted darter, and went off with a queer sort of a circus woman, one of her own kin, and I reckon one of her own kind." To this Mr. Hooker offered no further reply than a withering rebuke of the waiter, a genteel abstraction, and a lofty change of subject. He pressed upon them two tickets for the performance, of which he seemed to have a number neatly clasped in an india rubber band, and advised them to come early. They would see him after the performance and sup together. He must leave them now, as he had to be punctually at the theater, and if he lingered he should be pestered by interviewers. He withdrew under a dazzling display of cuff and white handkerchief, and with that inward swing of the arm and slight bowiness of the leg generally recognized in his profession as the lounging exit of high comedy. The mingling of awe and an uneasy sense of changed relations which that meeting with Jim had brought to Phoebe was not lessened when she entered the theater with her father that evening, and even Mr. Hopkins seemed to share her feelings. The theater was large, and brilliant in decoration, the seats were well filled with the same heterogeneous mingling she had seen in the dining room at the Placer Hotel, but in the parquet were some fashionable costumes and cultivated faces. Mr. Hopkins was not altogether so sure that Jim had been only gassing. But the gorgeous drop curtain, representing an allegory of Californian prosperity and abundance, presently uprolled upon a scene of Western life almost as striking in its glaring unreality. From a rose-clad English cottage in a subtropical landscape skipped Rosalie, the prairie flower. The briefest of skirts, the most unsullied of stockings, the tiniest of slippers, and the few diamonds that glittered on her fair neck and fingers, revealed at once the simple and unpretending daughter of the American backwoodsman. A tumult of delighted greeting broke from the audience. The bright color came to the pink, girlish cheeks, gratified vanity danced in her violet eyes, and as she piquantly bowed her acknowledgments, this great breath of praise seemed to transfigure and possess her. A very young actor who represented the giddy world in a straw hat and with an effeminate manner was alternately petted and girded at by her during the opening exposition of the plot, until the statement that a dark destiny obliged her to follow her uncle in an emigrant train across the plains closed the act, apparently extinguished him, and left her the central figure. So far, she evidently was the favorite. A singular aversion to her crept into the heart of Phoebe. But the second act brought an Indian attack upon the emigrant train, and here Rosalie displayed the archiest heroism and the pinkest and most distracting self-possession, in marked contrast to the giddy worldling who, having accompanied her apparently for comic purposes best known to himself, cowered abjectly under wagons, and was pulled ignominiously out of straw, until Red Dick swept out of the wings with a chosen band and a burst of revolvers and turned the tide of victory. Attired as a picturesque combination of the Neapolitan smuggler, river bar miner, and Mexican vaquero, Jim Hooker instantly began to justify the plaudits that greeted him and the most sanguinary hopes of the audience. A gloomy but fascinating cloud of gunpowder and dark intrigue from that moment hung about the stage. Yet in this somber obscuration Rosalie had passed a happy 6 months, coming out with her character and stockings equally unchanged and unblemished, to be rewarded with the hand of Red Dick and the discovery of her father, the governor of New Mexico, as a white-haired, but objectionable vaquero, at the fall of the curtain. Through this exciting performance Phoebe sat with a vague and increasing sense of loneliness and distrust. She did not know that Hooker had added to his ordinary inventive exaggeration the form of dramatic composition. But she had early detected the singular fact that such shadowy outlines of plot as the piece possessed were evidently based on his previous narrative of his own experiences, and the saving of Susy Peyton by himself. There was the episode of their being lost on the plains, as he had already related it to her, with the addition of a few years to Susie's age and some vivid picturesqueness to himself as Red Dick. She was not, of course, aware that the part of the giddy worldling was Jim's own conception of the character of Clarence. But what, even to her provincial taste, seemed the extravagance of the piece, she felt, in some way, reflected upon the truthfulness of the story she had heard. It seemed to be a parody on himself, and in the laughter which some of the most thrilling points produced in certain of the audience, she heard an echo of her own doubts. But even this she could have borne if Jim's confidence had not been given to the general public, it was no longer hers alone, she shared it with them. And this strange, bold girl, who acted with him the Blanche Belleville of the Bills, how often he must have told her the story, and yet how badly she had learned it. It was not her own idea of it, nor of him. In the last extravagant scene, she turned her weary and half-shamed eyes from the stage and looked around the theater. Among a group of loungers by the wall, a face that seemed familiar was turned towards her own with a look of kindly and sympathetic recognition. It was the face of Clarence Brandt. When the curtain fell, and she and her father rose to go, he was at their side. He seemed older and more superior looking than she had ever thought him before, and there was a gentle yet sad wisdom in his eyes and voice that comforted her even while it made her feel like crying. "You are satisfied that no harm has come to our friend," he said pleasantly. "Of course you recognized him."
"Oh, yes, we met him today," said Phoebe.
Her provincial pride impelled her to keep up a show of security and indifference. "We are going to supper with him." Clarence slightly lifted his brows. "You are more fortunate than I am," he said smilingly. "I only arrived here at 7, and I must leave at midnight." Phoebe hesitated a moment, then said with affected carelessness, "What do you think of the young girl who plays with him? Do you know her?"
"Who is she?"
He looked at her quickly, and then said, with some surprise, "Did he not tell you?" "She was the adopted daughter of Mrs. Peyton, Miss Susan Silsby," he said gravely. "Then she did run away from home, as they said," said Phoebe impulsively. "Not exactly as they said," said Clarence gently. "She elected to make her home with her aunt, Mrs. McCloskey, who is the wife of the manager of this theater, and she adopted the profession a month ago. As it now appears that there was some informality in the old articles of guardianship, Mrs. Peyton would have been powerless to prevent her from doing either, even if she had wished to." The infelicity of questioning Clarence regarding Susy suddenly flashed upon the forgetful Phoebe, and she colored. Yet, although sad, he did not look like a rejected lover. "Of course, if she is here with her own relatives, that makes all the difference," she said gently. "It is protection."
"Certainly," said Clarence.
"And," continued Phoebe hesitatingly, "she is playing with an old friend, Mr. Hooker."
"That is quite proper, too, considering their relations," said Clarence tolerantly.
"I don't understand," stammered Phoebe. The slightly cynical smile on Clarence's face changed as he looked into Phoebe's eyes. "I've just heard that they are married," he returned gently.